You've been the longest, Jack, yes? With Paul? Or have you all... You've been Mark, the longest with Paul.
No, I've since his first movie. Yeah, I designed the costumes. I designed the costumes for Hard Sydney, which was released as Hard 8. So that was 1995.
So how did you guys hook up in the first place?
You know, I think someone recommended me to Paul, and then we met. We went for breakfast. Yeah, I liked him. I thought he was interesting. And then I went and took him to a short film that I designed that was showing one evening at the Writers Guild. And he liked what I did with the outerwear. And we were going to be shooting nights in Reno, Nevada, so that we were going to need outerwear. So he said, okay, come on, let's do it. And, you know, I think we had maybe $10,000 for the costumes. Mm. And Sam Jackson and Gwyneth Paltrow and... And it was a great experience, and we're still here 17 years later, you know?
So is it very different working with him all these years later, or is he pretty much the same guy?
Not really. No, I don't think so. I think it's maybe, you know, as he matures as a filmmaker, I think, as I think we all do, you kind of loosen the reins a little bit. You allow yourself to be a little more freeform. Mm-hmm. I think early on he had producers kind of telling him, like, you've got to make your day and you've got to get this many pages done and things like that. And you know, he's very conscientious on that. And now I think he's like, you know what, I need to take time with this. We can't do it. We'll make it up someplace else. I think that's about the only thing that's changed. But he still has a really unerring eye about what things should be. And, you know, if he doesn't like the look of it when we shoot it, we'll do it again.
And There Will Be Blood, he replaced one of the lead actors 6 weeks in and stayed on schedule. And we reshot everything a couple times. He's so amazing.
You're kind of used to that with Mr. Malik.
Yeah.
is it a coincidence that you and Paul get along after your relationship with Terry for all those years?
I think Paul's really easy to get along with. He's got a great sense of humor. And I think he probably called me because of my work with Terry. And I met him the first time looking for locations on There Will Be Blood. And he was great. I think if you fit into his sort of circle, that it, you know, you've got a place as long as you keep delivering.
You feel comfortable in the circle?
Yeah. So far.
I see you shaking your head.
That's true.
Yeah.
I mean, he's very inclusive, fast, I think, if he likes you.
Yeah.
So does it take a while to figure out how he wants to work or exactly what it is, or is it just very clear from the beginning and fit or you don't?
I don't know about the others, but for me, we're all trying to figure it out at the beginning of every film. Is you don't know, you know, and when I first started working with him, I didn't have any idea how to do the physical stuff that we'd have to do for There Will Be Blood, and I told him that, and I think he sort of appreciated it, you know, because he was also trying to figure out his things. So
you just figure it out as you go, and
yeah,
it comes together.
You hope.
Well, you know, I think he's got a really clear vision, but he's open too to what you're going to bring to the table. I mean, I do find that a lot with my work. You know, he knows what he likes, and
he has to know a lot because he writes the stories, and you can't write them if you can't some visual idea. But I think he's open to.
Yeah, he's always really anxious to see what everybody's bringing. I mean, when you bring pictures out, it's amazing to watch his face kind of light up.
And he has a reaction right away too. Sometimes silence is good, because you're just waiting for that reaction. But okay, let's just move on. I didn't get anything, you know. And he just stores it all in. He has a really great color sense too. There's been a few times on films where he really needed to change a color. Have you experienced that with him at all? Any color?
I have a little different problem. We were working on There Will Be Blood, and one day he said, "You're getting to pick all the colors." You know, because every time I talk to him about something, he says, "Well, paint it white." And I go, "No, it's not right for this film." And because I think on the one he did with Adam Sandler, he did a lot of white.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so then he said, "Well, you're picking all the colors." So I gave him the new Benjamin Moore color chart. And I watched it. He had it with him for about 4 days. And we moved to California. We're getting ready to do that interior of the well. And he came over one day, and he handed me the color chart back. He said, here, you pick them.
See, that's
it
good.
It took us 2 months. It took us 2 months on Punch Drunk Love to get the color of Adam's suit right in
is
the lab.
Is that right?
Wow.
It was amazing. I mean, every time we'd walk in, I would think, oh, this is great. We got it. We got it. It's so vibrant. And he would say, no, I think you can pull more out. Get any more out of it. And next time we go in, sure enough.
But I think if he sees something he likes, he knows it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And
was there more of it on the set, or was it just that he figured he'd ramp it up in post?
You know, I wasn't on the set on Punch Drunk Love. I came on later, and so I didn't. All I knew about Adam's suit was what I saw in the Avid. And then when we got into the lab, and it was incredible. He knew what that suit was going to look like on Kodak stock, on Fuji stock, on, you know, every stock he knew, and what kind of soup we had that day in the lab. He knew what that suit was going to look like and what it should look like. And so he's like that all the time with color. And so it starts early on.
That's what I'm saying. And you know, we did, there was a big psych on the television game show set, Magnolia. And we had done it was kind of that 60s gold, because it was supposed to be a game show that had been around. And he walks in there one day and he's like, this can't be gold. And he's like, can we get a red one? And, you know, it ended up, you know, we went, set decorator, got, you know, whoever got, and it was wine, and it really was the right thing to do. And on this, The Master, you know, Amber comes off of the yacht in this sort of mouse brown, it's kind of a taupe dress, and she's got the fur coat and everything. Once they got into that hotel room, I get a call from Cookie on the set saying, Paul wants to change her dress. Now, we had shot all that stuff with the coming off the yacht and everything up in Vallejo.
Right.
So, and I was like, what does he want to change it to? And he says, you know, something with a lot more life, like something red. Do you have a red dress? And because it's just, he's just like, that brown one is just laying there, kind of just sits there on the couch. And I'm like, oh no, what do we got? And then luckily, I always do fit a closet for these actors. They may not always use them all, or I may not. So luckily, I had a red dress. And this is why I say he's got the taste, he knows the colors, because you look at that scene and her in that room and what's happening at the moment, and it is much better for that beat.
Yeah. And There Will Be Blood, he did that in the real estate office. We'd done it sort of medium brown. He goes, no, I want it dark, you know. And we ended up with walls that were almost black. And I was trying to, you know, bring some life in there. But then we did them black, and they look great.
There's a scene in The Master that's just so beautiful that I love. And then it's the scene. It's the conference in Phoenix. And there's the banners and the
on the crepe paper,
the split saber banner and the crepe paper, the blues and the greens, and then at the end of that conference, which isn't in the movie, there's the Phil dancing with Laura with amazing costumes. Anyway, it just, the combination of those colors were just stunning. I don't know how much Paul had to do with that.
It was more what we could get.
For me, I had a special palette for Arizona.
Right.
Like, there's colors in there that you don't see anywhere else. You don't see the rust. You know, I tried to use like cactus green and stuff, and golds. And you guys, this happens more than once that we come together.
We're working off the same research.
But it's also, I think there's a sensibility too. Like, you know, I tried to do different palettes in that movie, and I brought that to you and said, like, this is what I'm bringing to the table. Is this going to work for what you're doing? You know, and it's so that you got a sense of place. Like, the yacht had a certain set of colors. And then once we went to Philly and New York, it felt a little more East Coast and then Southwest. And hopefully you feel it without it knocking you over the head. So
you know what I thought was wonderful for, and I didn't know if it would work, was the department store, the backdrop being that yellow.
And oh God,
it was exquisite.
Loves that.
And that was a case where you go to the store, what have you got? And they got yellow, and you put it in there, and it just worked great. It really gave you a sense of technicolor of the period.
But you didn't say change it to red afterwards, huh?
No.
You're in good shape. No. Do you how long a conversation do you have with him about the palettes, for instance, and the different places you're going and things like that? Or do you? Or is that just a trust thing at this point?
I'll have the conversation with Jack. I usually don't bother Paul with these things. I don't want him, because, see, I think he'll get afraid and be like, is that going to look too designed? You know, because we like it to seem kind of offhand and
kinda
real.
Throw it away, yeah.
And so you start, you know, too much talk is like, let's just do it, do you know? And
yeah, we'll, I find that with Paul and with Terry that we don't talk about the sets much at all.
No. We know shapes, we know characters, we know, I'll tell him how I'm hoping to move the story ahead with a certain costume at a certain beat, but as far, I don't want it, hopefully he won't notice it, and I know color is his really, he's great with the color, so hopefully I'll do it subtly enough, throw in enough random stuff to around it that you don't really see that it's a palette for a certain area until it's done.
I think we're also so fast that if we make a mistake or have to change something, it could be done without even anyone knowing. Kind of. David?
But there's also a lot of talk at the beginning, I think, when you, in the first weeks, where you just kind of, you're with him all the time.
And he likes to go look at location.
And you talk around a whole lot of stuff. So by the end, you kind of know what the world is without ever having to talked about those specific pieces. But I think it's because he loves to come.
I was in Hawaii, but the evolution of the pub set. No. I love to let you talk about that for a minute.
Well, we had two things. We had that little set that we had to do an insert shot for the liquor being poured from the boat. And all I'd been told was it was a close-up on this picture. And it was just going to be the hand pouring it. So I go over there, and the camera's like way back. And there's like all this thing. And we're standing there, and the script supervisor, I can't remember her name, there was a ladder that was supposed to be there that had, it said like emergency or something right on the side of it. And she goes, and Paul looks at me, and he goes, David? And I said, well, I thought it was an extreme close-up of a picture. And he goes, well, it was till I started to improvise. So we ran and we found a ladder very fast.
But then you built the whole pub set.
We did. We had to redo the pub in about 3 hours because he decided he wanted a fourth wall on it. So
you know,
we had to extend it and get new paintings and add.
It was
more
one shot and then it became a scene.
Yeah. It was already like three times more than what he'd asked for, and then he got there, and then it was like, well, can't it have a fourth wall? I was like, yeah. It was a few minutes.
And it was very near the end.
It was. It was the last day.
It's like with you in the red dress.
Do you guys have any scraps? We can make a fourth wall. You know, whatever. And there, you know, let's dress Adam. Let's dress so-and-so to be in the pub. You know, let's dress everybody on the crew who's English.
That's right.
To be in the English pub.
We took part of the hallway out of the hotel and just pulled it around and repainted it.
So does he tell you his secrets? Does he talk to you about the subtext? Particularly in a movie like The Master, where it's so much of it is subtext. Do you have that conversation ever, or are you just doing your read and doing your job?
I don't ever remember having, you know, going beyond the story.
No, and you guys actually have more time with him. You know, you're talking about going on all those location scouts and stuff. You know, we'll have a couple of meetings. I'll certainly show him all the book and how we're going to do things. What's great is he will come to fittings. Like, he came to Joaquin's first two fittings and Phil's first fitting and stuff. So I guess that's my version of you guys having him on a scout. Yeah. But no, we all just talk and then we do our things and change as necessary, but it doesn't seem like we scramble a lot.
You know, I loved about this film, and I hadn't been aware of it before, but when Leslie and Paul were putting together all these trailers in the beginning, they were using all the footage that was not in the film.
Yeah.
And it was so much fun to see it, you know? It sort of was a story, and you realize that you hadn't seen the best scenes in the film in the trailer, and it was all like downhill from there.
Yeah, we didn't know until we actually saw the movie. Yeah. You guys actually knew that it was already been cut out. We're just kind of guessing out there in the world. Trailer for Chicago, trailer for San Francisco, trailer for New York. It was very scary. So what's it like when you finally get to post? Are you along the way? Are you there through the picture?
I just coincidentally, I wasn't involved during production on either film that I did, Punch Drunk Love and Master. It just didn't work out on either film that way. So I came on, and there was a first cut of the movie. Uh-huh. And I just jumped in with him and, you know, to work.
So does the footage all pile up, or when did you start cutting?
No, it was cut. There was a cut.
There was another cutter.
There was a cut. Okay. Yeah. Peter McNulty cut it together. And it was great. It was, you know, in great shape. It was just early in the process.
I saw one version where everything was taken out.
Right.
Yeah, and then the next time I saw it, everything was put
back.
Well,
when I came on, it was long. You know, he wrote a long script. There was a lot of extra stuff in there, and he knew. You know, he knew it was going to be long, and it was just a process of taking stuff out. And it's so common where you don't trust so much stuff because the movie's not working when it's so long, so you just tend to just be brutal and take everything out, and then you have to start putting things back in and trusting.
So him carving away is not unusual in your experience as a director?
No, not at all.
Is there anything unusual about him as a director when working with him in post? Is there a thing you guys have that?
You know, the way he works with music is really unique, and it's a luxury to have music, have your score before you finish cutting, and that's what he manages to do.
Yeah, and he would play music at dailies.
He got well. He had music.
First of all, he had
Johnny
dailies
Dunn,
on
or?
Film.
No, yeah. Johnny.
He would have sometimes pieces from Johnny.
Johnny
would send them.
Would do sketches. Yeah. Johnny did sketches of the score before he had shot anything. So Paul has conversations with the composer about feelings, you know, tone. Talks about the story and characters, but there's not a frame of film shot. So Johnny did several sketches, different tones, different styles, jazz, percussion, you know, a lot of different styles. And so we used those sketches. That was our temp score. We never used anything other than Johnny's music. Mm-hmm. And that music informed the cut informed more music. So it was a, you know, give and take, and it was wonderful to work that way.
Plus, he had some period pieces like "Get Behind Me, Satan."
Mm-hmm. Yeah, all his songs.
He had
songs.
A bunch of songs
he
like
knew
that,
what those songs
like
were. Yeah.
Maybe a dozen songs or something.
Yeah.
Or
you'd be shooting a scene. Like, I think it was that scene, the long dolly shot, the 400-foot dolly shot with the boat, and suddenly you'd hear, he'd have on speakers the music coming out.
So does he do that for you guys as well, or is that just the tone of the set that day? I mean, is he looking to inspire all of you into?
I think most? So.
I think it works.
You know
it
what does. Else that?
I don't know if that's his intention.
Are you talking about the shot when Freddie's coming up onto the yacht
for the first time?
Like yeah. That was the kind of the bongo music or something.
Yeah.
It was really. Like the party music from that was really exciting out there.
Yeah, that he would have playback music playing that you had to use. I mean, that was married to the production track, and that was that's what you end up in. That ends up in the final version of the movie, which is uncommon.
Well, it's funny because this year you also had the Wachowskis, who had Tom Twyker working with them, directing with them, and he wrote the score for that movie before they shot.
I heard an interview
with them. And they were very into it.
Yesterday, talking about the same thing, I think they got their score early on too.
Yeah. Now they want to work with Tom and everything so they can get the score early, because he also, the director who also does scoring, so it's a different combination. So does it feel piecemeal at all, or do you feel it all coming together as you're sitting there in the set, or is it just so big that it's hard to conceptualize how this is all going to come together in the end?
I think it seems like Paul pretty much has his film, you know, in his mind.
Mm-hmm.
The thing I like about Paul is that he loves to have dailies projected, and he encourages people to come to dailies. And to me, that always unifies a crew so that we all know what film we're making. It's the same film. Mm-hmm. And, you know, things happen, but the tone is there, and I think that he's, a great thing about Paul for me is that he's real inclusive of all of us that work with him.
It doesn't seem like many directors do that anymore. It's kind of gone out of fashion.
I think it is kind of gone out. Yeah. Yeah. People are watching on DVDs, you know, at their, or on their iPad. Yeah. And it's very seldom you get in a room with a projector. And
you wouldn't be allowed to watch it on your iPad if it was Paul. It seemed like
I don't think so.
Subterfuge somehow to actually watch it anything but 70 would be.
And I've been on two shows recently where I don't think I ever saw a daily.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So to have that experience is a real luxury.
It feels much more collaborative.
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. And it's not just
he loves filmmaking. I think as much as he, you know, as anything.
The experience of doing of that those days on set and sharing all that. So is it how hard is it when it ends?
It is hasn't it? Ended. He is still doing. He is in control of the trailers, the ads, the Academy consideration ads, the DVD packaging. That it's just going on forever.
And is that
won't
like
let go of it.
A really and great thing for you guys? Is that what you want from a director? If you had your druthers?
Well, I really appreciate it. I appreciate it a lot. Yeah.
Yeah.
And you know, we're thinking about maybe the next thing too with Paul too. Mm-hmm. So you're finishing up the last one, and we're thinking of starting to think about the next one. So
so you're moving that quickly this time. Because it was a while between movies.
Hopefully it depends. But you know, so
he always has something in the hopper. Sometimes for reason of cast or money or something, you know, things are postponed. But I think he never slows down. Huh. He's always going forward.
And is it special that you guys have worked together repeatedly? I mean, is that part of what makes it work for him? And like Spielberg's crew is, you know, always kind of waiting for the call. Any minute they're going to go off and shoot something for, you know, whenever. It feels like this group, he's developed this group as for people he'd come back to over and over again, and that they're, it must be easier somehow to do it there than him try to explain himself to somebody new each time.
I think he started at milepost 3 instead of milepost 1.
I think he really treasures his support team, because I see now he's trying to figure out when everybody's going to be available at the same time, and that's kind of gearing a lot of his startup date.
Mm-hmm. So what's the bad part of all this? Is there a bad part to it? Is there a hard something that just like, oh God, I wish I wouldn't be doing that again?
I think he's a very exciting filmmaker to work with.
The act of filmmaking, does it also, what's your relationship to the film that comes out at the end as production designers and
costume designers? Way more than what I was expecting.
Absolutely,
actually.
And I look at it and, you know, I remember getting very choked up when watching dailies of Hard Eight. From the very first movie that we did, we watched them on a sheet in the production office in Reno, and thinking there's some beautiful stuff going on here. And I, first time I saw this, The Master, I was touched again, thinking, yeah, I'm so proud to be part of something this beautiful.
I think we all give a lot of stuff, you know, a big contribution. And when you see how he uses it, it's rewarding, you know. I think I was pleasantly elated when I saw the film.
Me too.
I thought he made use of everything he was given.
Hmm. So he's precise in that way. You know, he's not wasteful.
He's not wasteful, and he's appreciative, and I think he's been able to guide us a little bit, you know, in the making of the film, so that he got stuff that he could use, and he knew how to use it. You know?
Mm-hmm. And did the content of this film, and the fact that it was, I assume being in 70 doesn't really affect anybody except for maybe you, but does the goal of this and the period and everything else make it harder for you guys? Or is it just another film to make, another challenge as artists? Is there something especially hard about it, or is it?
I think we look for challenges.
Yeah.
The fact that it's period, it's also a strange period because it's, you know, I was alive during that film, so it doesn't seem like period to me. But, but to make it seem like something that's, that represents that period is a challenge, and it's much more exciting to me than just, you know, shooting a present day film.
Was there something particular, any particular single thing that was extremely challenging in this, or just all of it?
It was to do in San Francisco and LA, do a film that took place in New York, Philadelphia, yeah. Phoenix. Mm-hmm. You know, it was bringing all that together into a small venue, and you know, sort of trying to fool the audience into believing it was much bigger than it was, and working with a tight budget, mm-hmm. tight schedule. You know, some sets we had great fun with, like the department store. Mm-hmm. You know, sets we didn't build but I loved was the jail in San Pedro. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was, Paul described what he wanted in the way of a cell, and you know, he was anxious to shoot it, but we never found it until we saw that jail cell, where you could look from one cell into another, and the, mm-hmm. you know, put the Philip Seymour's character in that position with Joaquin's character, mm-hmm. so close but separated by those bars. It was,
so when you talked about that, for instance, was that a detailed conversation about that specific kind of cell, or was it about story and how the story is?
It was about the image that he wanted, you know, was the two of them separated by bars. Mm-hmm. Now, most jails don't, they're not that open.
Right. You know,
they have a piece of steel in between. And
or cement, I would imagine, between them, though.
Yeah, a lot of times it's steel. Yeah, the ones we saw on Mirror Island were steel, but could be cement. But I know he was anxious to shoot the scene. He was trying to figure out how he could make it work, like put him in the same cell and stuff, but then...
We did shoot it up there on Mirror Island too, didn't we?
No. We looked at a cell that was...
Didn't they shoot in that prison though?
No.
That one that was off Mirror Island? It was like a city jail? Did we end up shooting there?
No, we shut down here.
It also feels really period that, you know, like bringing a baby kind of has that row of jail cells like that too. But this one was particularly kind of dangerous and safe at the same time, because the halfway up that metal, it was just ideal. And you know, sometimes we'll run into that with the costumes too, that it's like divine intervention. I talk about that a lot, you know, the costume gods or whatever, and it sounds like it bleeds over to everything that like fortuitous.
The challenge we had was finding England, you know, that he had started a school in England. And where do you find that in Los Angeles? You know, we looked around at all the mansions and stuff to try and replicate something similar to what Paul described. Mm. And then at the last week when we were in San Francisco, we found this great elementary school that was pretty much vacant. There was a chess school there, but it was pretty much vacant. Mm-hmm. And it had the auditorium with that huge window in it. And I remember getting excited, took Paul to see it, and he loved it. And decided to put just a sheet outside that window, so it was just white. You didn't see the trees or Berkeley. It was in Berkeley, mm-hmm. and it made it very stylized. But you know, I thought it was really strong.
It was perfect for that.
Yeah.
And if you'd never found it, you probably would have just he would have come up with some other thing.
Yeah, we would have gone to England, I think.
How many days did you actually shoot?
About 50 days.
I can't remember.
Yeah. Somewhere between 40 and 50 days, I think.
It is a short schedule for there's a lot of movie in there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And how long did you cut?
Eight months, maybe.
And did you cut right up to the end, or was that? I mean, it always is interesting because Paul is, in some ways, I think part of it's being a showman, the showman that he, you know, there's always this kind of interesting thing about the secrets of the movie. Was he done a lot sooner than we realized? Is it a wet print?
You know, he's very respectful of schedule, actually. So when there is a schedule, he really pays attention to that. But I love this about him. He, when there's a lock picture date, he wants to lock it all at once. It's not like lock reel one and ship it and we'll work on the rest of the movie. Just lock the whole thing and he commits to it. And he, if he has the time to sort of prepare, and then he's going to conform to that schedule and be okay with it. And that's what happened.
And then
we were free to kind of, you know, relax for a little bit and then go up to the mix, Skywalker, and he was completely, you know, okay with where we were at.
That's what I was saying, too, about and there would be blood to replace an actor 6 weeks in, reshoot everything that the other actor was in.
And come in on schedule.
And come in on schedule.
Yeah.
And we were right. to the day.
Well, it's funny because there's always that idea of the mad director or the mad genius. He had all these things, but it sounds like the real answer is that he's a mad normal guy who actually respects the rules.
You know what he likes to do is he likes to send the print to his head. He has a projection room in his house, and he likes to just have it at his house over the weekend, maybe a few weeks before we have to lock picture, and he'll just have a projectionist sort of on call, and he'll put his kids to bed and then go in and watch it a couple times through and by himself, and he'll just sit with it for a while and comes in Monday morning with a few things, but you know, nothing major. He just has to feel settled, and you know, and then he's good to go.
And do you guys see it at all in that process, or do you see the end result? You see it as he's also cutting?
We will see
different versions of it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So I guess are solicited for your opinions as well at that point?
We did that in January, I think, at some point. Yeah, he had a few people over and we looked at that particular version of it, and he doesn't
do it a lot, but he does it with his close friends and crew, and you know, he's sort of protective of showing it to too many people. He doesn't want to confuse his own instincts.
He seems to have a sense of history. You know, like this, when it's done, when the art is finally on the wall, it's going to be there for a very, very long time.
But I mean, I feel fortunate. I'm thinking, you know, when we did There Will Be Blood, I remember the first table read we had for it, you know, in his projection room there, you know, Phil's there, and Joanne was reading roles, and, you know, I was probably the mayor or something, And so we went from table read to that beautiful final product. And so I really feel privileged to be included in all those steps of that film.
Yeah. That was the first film I worked with Paul on, but we went and looked at locations in Texas and New Mexico and Los Angeles. And then we decided we really liked Texas because it was so rough and rugged. And then I went off and did another film, and he went back to L.A. because Daniel Day didn't want to work during the school year because of his kids in school. So he said, well, we'll meet back here in a year. And I really, you know, it's amazing, the patience and the time. And
it was all there.
Yeah.
That stuff wasn't going anywhere, I guess. But it really is a big character in the picture. I mean, it's amazing how much, you know, you guys talk about how he loves each department. You know, he makes all these pieces really much, really a part of the film. It's not that you know, they're not jumping out at you and going, oh, look at the costume or look at that thing, but you really do experience every sensation while you're watching these movies.
Yeah, I think that's what we all strive for, too, is to be there but not be there.